Yeah. Okay. So whenever I start, I'll click start record, right? Okay. Should I hang up now? Yeah. Okay. So if I hang up now, can you hear me over the computer? Can you hear me, Kiana? Can you hear me okay? Hello, good morning everyone. Hope you all can hear me. Really appreciate you all taking a Monday morning to join us today. And thanks a lot to IEEE Women in Engineering for creating this opportunity for us to chat. So first of all, I am a co-founder of Nepris. Nepris is an education technology company based in Texas. I've been in education technology for over 18 years. It's mostly my background is in electrical engineering. I also have a master's in computer science, and I ended up doing an MBA just a few years back. So when we started Nepris, I am one of the co-founders, and when we started Nepris, we had one core mission. How do we help bridge the gap between industry and education? How can we connect more educators with industry professionals like you to bring real-world relevance to classrooms with one main purpose: to inspire and engage more students in STEM? So most of you may already know what STEM is, but I just wanted to give you a brief overview of what I mean by STEM and what are the professions that generally fall under this category. So the three big areas are first computer and math occupations. Many of you may already be in some of these jobs. You may be programmers, database analysts, systems analysts, network engineers. And then there's the engineering, which also includes civil engineering, chemical engineering, biomedical, nuclear, petroleum. The third big category is physical and life sciences, all of the healthcare professions that is included in the STEM. So within all of these three, there is also the component of STEM management, right? So if you look at it, no matter where you, what kind of job you are, there is a layer of management responsibilities like program managers or marketing managers. So all of these jobs also fall under a STEM category. So you may, many of you may have already heard a lot of discussions around bridging the STEM pipeline gap. So I noticed that some of you are logging in from different countries, so I'm not sure how familiar you are with this being a big issue in the US. So if you actually Google for a STEM pipeline gap, you will actually see a lot of visuals. One of my favorite data is where it shows a pipeline talking about if there are 4 million kids in ninth grade, by the time they come out of this pipeline, there are dropouts all the way along. In high school, by the time they graduate high school, there are only 2.7 million kids. By the time they go into college, there are only 1.8 million. At the end of this pipeline of going from high school to college to into a STEM career, graduating college successfully, because there's a huge dropout rate in college as well. So by the time they get out of this pipeline, qualified and ready to take these STEM jobs, you have only 165,000 STEM graduates. And this number is even lower if you look at the women in STEM professions. So some of the other data as far as salary, which is sometimes a main criteria for taking jobs, the average US salary for any job is $43,000, right? But if you look at a STEM salary, the average is nearly $78,000. So you have all these jobs that are high paying with better retention that many of our kids, especially girls, are not taking. So today, as part of this discussion, I just wanted to point out a few things as to what is contributing to the STEM pipeline gap, how can we engage more girls in STEM, and how can you build your professional profile while trying to contribute to help bridge this problem, right? So, for example, there was a study, I think, done by the US Census Bureau. It's called the American Community Survey. One of the key indicators they talked about was actually women are doing really well as far as taking jobs. Women actually contribute 48% of the total workforce compared to 52% men. So, but when it comes to STEM jobs, these numbers really go down. There are only 24% of women in any kind of STEM job, while there are 76% men taking these jobs. So one of the other things in a STEM profession, I'm not sure if you have noticed, is STEM professions also, there is less wage disparity in a STEM job. For example, in a regular job, there is a 21% difference between a salary earned by a male counterpart compared to a female in the same profession or same job. But when you come to a STEM job, that wage disparity actually reduces a whole lot. It drops from 21% to only 14%. So for every dollar earned by a man, women in STEM earn around 86 cents. Well, it's not equal, but it's not bad either, right? So given all these huge benefits, higher salary, better retention, less wage disparity, so why aren't women getting into STEM professions? Actually, to tell you the truth, it's not really women are not getting into STEM professions. There is a good percentage of women in STEM professions. If we actually delve deeper and split STEM professions into, you know, the life sciences, computer science, engineering, where do you think women are actually spending, most of their career? It's, if you look at the physical and life sciences degree, right, men actually hold 31% of the physical and life sciences degree. And I was very, very surprised when I first saw this data. Actually, 57% of women actually hold a physical or life sciences degree. So you have a lot more women in healthcare as doctors, as nurses, as psychologists. But when you come to an engineering degree, you have 48% men and only 18% women. So in short, many of the social and life sciences, women have reached parity in percentages of degrees received and the jobs being taken. So in other areas such as geosciences, mathematics, and physical sciences, the percentage of women, they continue to increase, but have not really approached parity. There are still more men in these roles. But when it comes to engineering and computer sciences, these two are actually the fastest growing STEM fields with the greatest workforce demand. The percentage of women have really reached a plateau, or actually even worse, it's dropped in the past decade. So as women in engineering, some of you may know already what are the contributing factors, right? Why do we have lesser and lesser women going into engineering and computer sciences? So many times the first thing that comes to my mind is, for generations there's been a very strong gender stereotype, right? So I mean, even growing up, I always had the impression that men took certain jobs and women took certain other kind of jobs. So over the last generation, I'm sure this has reduced to some extent because our kids are seeing us as role models. We are women in engineering, and we are good role models, not just to our kids, but to other girls in the community as well. But still today, some of these gender stereotypes exist. So these can lead to lack of self-confidence, a growth versus fixed mindset. So what can we do to bridge this gap, right? Just to kind of give you a lighter way of looking at this, many of us as parents sometimes are not really happy when our kids play with the Barbie dolls, right? Because if you look at the most popular Barbies, they're always a pop diva or a fashion model or a princess in distress, right? So it's really not, I mean, these kind of toys are not really helping bridge this gender stereotype, but to the makers of Barbie, they have to be credited to some extent, because what many of us don't know is Barbie has been a very successful career woman since 1963. In 1963, Barbie was an executive. In 1965, she was an astronaut. In 1973, a surgeon. 1992, a presidential candidate. So in 2009, a pediatrician. In 2010, a computer engineer, and a very fashionable one too. And so the point that I want to make with this is, starting at a very young age, everything that our kids are seeing, not just in what we do, what's around them, are really helping them form images and help them break down these stereotypes. So for example, with NEPRIS, our job today is we're helping connect students and classrooms with role models like you, right? So the reason I mentioned this is, recently we had a session where we had a computer engineer, not a computer engineer, actually an engineer from Raytheon, a woman engineer, connect with the classroom to talk about how she applies chemical reactions in her job at Raytheon. So the teacher wrote back to us right after the session. This was a 30-minute discussion with the class. So she wasn't only talking about chemical reactions. What she was giving the kids an opportunity was to see, or to get a glimpse into her life as an engineer working for a well-known company like Raytheon, right? So at the end of this, the teacher wrote to us and said, I mean, this was not just a great session as far as connecting content to real-world application. Many of my girls who had the idea that an engineer is someone in a white coat or a lab coat and glasses. Well, there's nothing wrong with wearing a white coat and glasses, but the reality is that the girls have the stereotype image of an engineer. And the teacher said, just with this 30 minutes of helping connect them with this very successful woman in this engineering role, they have changed their perspective. That the girls came back from the class and said, well, if engineers can look so good and still be so successful, I wouldn't mind being an engineer, right? I mean, that is the reality. At a young age, like in elementary school and middle school, a lot of it has to do with, do I have to lose my identity to actually go become an engineer? And that's such a big barrier for most of the kids that at a very early age, they decide that they're not gonna go for it, right? Not knowing what the opportunities are or what the realities are. So a big contributing factor is, as women, work-life balance is so important, right? So today, many of the companies are acknowledging this and providing opportunities to work from home a few days a week, or you have a sick child. It's not really, we're fortunate to be living in a time where technology actually helps bridge some of these barriers and gives women more opportunities. So, I mean, we've done a lot of focus groups and research on why students, girls in general, are not pursuing these STEM careers in spite of all the benefits. And one of the big things that always comes back is the lack of role models. So if you think about it, I kind of pose this question to all of you. So when did you decide to become an engineer, right? For me, I come from an agriculture family. My parents own a coconut farm in India. I did not have many role models in my family or in my life. But there was one connection that made a huge difference. The only one in my family who actually had an engineering degree and was successful was my uncle. He was well respected. Everyone looked up to him, and he was an entrepreneur. And that, having him as a role model of someone who can be successful outside of agriculture, it made a lasting impression in my mind as I was growing up. So it really doesn't take a lot. It really doesn't take a lot to inspire the younger generation, right? Recently I read a research article where they talked about around 59% of boys and 67% of girls said it was just one incident or one event or one connection or just one person that made a huge difference and helped them pursue a STEM degree. So unfortunately, many kids, especially girls, don't have role models in their lives, right? I mean, they graduate high school without understanding what the real world looks like, what are their options. So, I mean, fortunately now, I think there is a lot more realization that this gap exists, and there are many, many organizations that are trying to create opportunities for girls. Many schools are also creating career pathways and providing opportunities to connect with the real world. So looking at this, one of the other barriers I see is actually humanizing the job. This is just how I formulate this in my head. I mean, what does humanizing the job mean, right? So why is there a huge percentage of women choosing life sciences as a career instead of choosing engineering? I mean, the good thing about girls is that you want to do a job that is fulfilling, that you can actually see the results of your contribution in more tangible terms, right? I mean, you want to be a doctor. Many girls want to be doctors or go into the healthcare profession because they know they can save lives. So how are we going to bring that sort of humanizing aspect to the engineering jobs, right? So we have a big task ahead of us in connecting what is happening in engineering to how it matters to women. So for example, take healthcare, where so many women are taking jobs. So today there is a lot of technology innovation in healthcare, in biomedical engineering. So the machines behind saving lives, the data, the programs, all of these touch upon various engineering professions. So how are we going to give an opportunity to the younger generation to see these connections? It's not straightforward like becoming a doctor, right? Everybody knows you become a doctor, you save lives. But how can you connect the fact that you're actually saving lives being a biomedical engineer too, right? So as IEEE Women in Engineering, we have a collection of women, a group of women who are highly accomplished, whose skills are relevant to all these discussions. So today, I want to put a challenge in front of you to say, take a step towards volunteering to share your skills with the next generation, right? And I'm sure many of you are already doing this in your own way. And some of you are thinking, yeah, I would like to do it, but it's easily said than done, right? So if you look at how can we actually volunteer and share our skills and knowledge with a classroom or with even just one kid and help inspire them. Today, there are lots and lots of opportunities, but there are also many barriers. So I just want to highlight a few of the barriers today and then talk about how you can take a step towards volunteering and what opportunities are available for you and what channels are available for you to be able to do that. So one of the biggest barriers in volunteering is it's lack of time. I mean, all of us go to work every day and we are so busy. We have so much to do at work. We are being measured on different things. We're traveling, we're also moms. We're balancing a lot of things. So there are lots of good intentions, but very little time. So the other thing is limited access, right? When we started NEPRIS, one of our key focus was how do we connect rural classrooms with professionals and give them the same opportunity that urban classrooms have. So today, geographic barriers loom large in realizing this goal of connecting professionals with the next generation of kids. So, and the other big thing we've seen is the lack of curriculum connection. So I've been working with teachers for a long time, teachers and students. I've been in education technology for over 18 years. So one of the big things we see is even when a professional takes the time to connect with the classroom or to work with a small group of students, when there is no connection to where what their skills are, to what curriculum is being taught in the classroom, there's very little incentive from a teacher perspective or from a school perspective to really continue engaging industry professionals in the classroom. So because, again, if you look at teachers, they are measured differently. They're accountable for student performance. So unless we tie the professional skills to the needs of the classroom, to connect what kids are learning in the classroom to how it's applied in the real world, and until we actually connect these dots and give professionals an opportunity to really apply their skills, whether it's 30 minutes or an hour of their connecting with the classroom, it's really not going to scale. And of course, there's always the schedule conflicts. Yeah, I want to do this, but the teacher wants or the school wants to connect with you next Wednesday morning at 8:30 because that's their time that they have, but you may not be available at that time. So there is no solution to schedule conflicts, but it is definitely a big problem today in making these connections a reality. And then there is the big communication gap, you know. So the teacher may want one thing, or the group of students may be working on one thing. How do they communicate what they're doing in the classroom and where they need help? How do they communicate this with you? Today, there's lots of, you know, channels for communication, and there's no one clear channel to really connect industry professionals into classroom. So what can you do today? You're saying, okay, I'm sold. Yes, I want to connect with the classroom or with a group of kids or with a single kid to mentor them. How do I do it? Right? So I would encourage you to first look at some of your local universities. Many of the local universities, at least in the US, they have a K-12 outreach team. Most departments have a K-12 outreach team because it is in the best interest of universities to inspire the K-12 students, because that is the pipeline that's actually coming in to take the college seats, right? So, and there are many, many organizations today that are helping focus on girls and giving them the opportunities to connect to STEM careers. So the National Girls Collaborative is one such organization. I'm sure you've all heard a lot about Girls Who Code and similar organizations like that. I'm in Texas. There are many local organizations like High Tech High Heels and so on. So you can reach out to one of these organizations and see whose mission actually ties well with what you want to do. I'm sure IEEE Women in Engineering also creates a lot of opportunities for you to connect with schools. The other easier way is also for you to go to LinkedIn and look at volunteer opportunities. In fact, NEPRIS is one of the organizations that work with LinkedIn to highlight these volunteer opportunities on the LinkedIn page. So based on your profile and your geographic location, you may see very relevant volunteer opportunities to connect with classrooms. So before I finish, I just wanted to quickly mention that when we started NEPRIS, we had one core mission, is to bring down many of these barriers, to make it so easy for professionals like you to contribute to the classroom anytime you wanted to, even if you had 30 minutes a year. How can we put the 30 minutes to good use and give you a channel and an opportunity to connect with the classroom or to connect with a group of kids? So since we launched NEPRIS early February, we've had over 2,000 teachers, nearly from 45 states, connecting with professionals from over 800 companies. We're also partnering with LinkedIn to actually publish many of these volunteer opportunities that come into the NEPRIS platform to get it in front of the millions of LinkedIn professionals who are looking for opportunities for education outreach. So I'm not sure if this data is 100% correct, but I remember hearing from LinkedIn that, you know, LinkedIn started the group called LinkedIn for Good just early this year, and they did a survey, I think, of their top 5% of LinkedIn users. And over 80% of LinkedIn users said they are looking for opportunities for outreach, and education was one of the key areas. So our goal at NEPRIS has been, how do we create a channel for all of you, all of these people who are interested in contributing to the classroom? How can we make it so easy for you to connect from your office, from your home, reach every corner of the country or even the world? So today we're connecting many different professionals with classrooms. We actually work with a lot of the organizations that I mentioned below, giving them a technology platform to help make these connections. So there's one thing you may say, you know, what's in it for me? You know, as a, I mean, we're all parents, we're employers, we're educators. Whatever your role is, getting more women involved in engineering is a top priority. That's going to help bridge many gaps. So, and at the end of the day, this is also a great opportunity for each and every one of you to build your individual profile through education outreach. So what do I mean by that, right? So today's leaders are not just the ones who are just good at doing their job. Today's leaders are the ones that are taking proactive interest in community development, in education outreach, in creating a model, a role model, or being a role model for many. So if you look at many of the successful women in engineering, they may have many patents, they may be great at their job, they are innovators, but they're also creating a footprint as far as outreach. They have a role to play in the community. They are taking the time and the effort to connect with the next generation and be an inspiration to many girls. So I want to conclude today and put a challenge in front of you. This year, make a resolution to give at least 10 hours of your time to connect with the classroom or to mentor a student, in general, to inspire the next generation of women in engineering. I thank you all for the opportunity. And if you have any questions, I think there's a way for you to ask questions or type it through Facebook. So go ahead. Well, I think Kiana stepped out for a minute, but if you all have questions, please go ahead and type it in. So any questions, anyone? So we have one question. So how did you choose your engineering field? So, I mean, I was talking about girls being interested in life sciences. Ever since I was a kid, I always wanted to be a doctor. But I also talked about my uncle, who was an engineer, a successful entrepreneur. So when I was in ninth grade, I got a chance to actually go do a summer internship with my uncle. This was in India. And his company actually manufactures printed circuit boards. And while I was there, I just kind of got exposed to a whole different world of possibilities of what technology could do. And that was really kind of my key defining moment of when I switched from wanting to be a doctor to be an engineer. And again, I wanted to, I did my undergrad in electrical engineering because that's really where I got my introduction to engineering first, is through an electrical engineer who was my uncle. And then as I did my undergrad in electrical engineering, programming and computer science was becoming more and more popular. There were very interesting applications that I was seeing happening around me. And it was a good time to consider switching from electrical to computer science. And I actually ended up doing my master's in computer science. So hopefully that answered your question. Kiana, any other questions? So we have a question from Heba. How does NEPRIS work in bringing students and industry closer for collaborative efforts like mutual projects on technology? That's a great question. I didn't talk much about NEPRIS because my focus was to sort of give you more exposure into what the issues are and what can you do to help. But definitely with NEPRIS, it's an online virtual platform. So if you go to nepris.com and sign up, you will see some of the How Stuff Works videos. So what we do is we talked about all the different geographic barriers, the barriers of how do you connect your skills to what is needed in the classroom. And we at NEPRIS, through the online platform, we make virtual connections, right? A teacher may submit a request saying, you know what, I am teaching refraction in my physics class. How is this applied in the real world? And our platform automatically matches that request with the profile of professionals in the platform. And then we manage the end-to-end process of inviting the professional to virtually connect with the classroom. And there are many steps behind the scenes where, I mean, many of you may know that it's not easy. Especially being an engineer, it's not easy to go back and talk to a class full of kids. Many of you may hesitate even to actually take that step towards talking with a high school class. It's just so intimidating. But at NEPRIS, behind the scenes, we also have developed a framework of best practices. And we make sure that you know how to connect your skills with the classroom, how to position yourself. So we do a little bit of training and coaching and give you the best chance of being successful in inspiring a class full of kids. My most gratifying career achievement is definitely starting this company, NEPRIS. And I actually talk with a bunch of groups about entrepreneurship and taking that step towards, quitting your well-paying job and going after something that you dream about. And for me, 2 years back, I did have a great job working for a Fortune 100 company. And many of us in this stage of life, we think, I have a great job. I have a lifestyle that I have to maintain. And I was in the same situation. I mean, it was very hard to walk away from a good paycheck. And it was a pretty good job. I was always very passionate about, STEM education. But more than that, to me, becoming an entrepreneur was really a goal that I wanted to achieve. And I felt fortunate that I was able to combine my passion in STEM education with my background in technology and actually pursue my dream of becoming an entrepreneur. And I still, till today, I think that has been my most gratifying career achievement, because we took it from something that was merely an idea one evening and built a product and built a company and built loyal customers around this. I don't think there's anything that can replace that feeling. So how does Nepris connect professionals to students? So I just briefly explained that. If you go to nepris.com, you can read about it and see a bunch of videos of how we do this. Today, Nepris is a teacher platform. So teachers actually post requests from classrooms, and then Nepris automatically matches teacher requests with the skills of professionals. We actually integrate with LinkedIn. So there is a lot of automatic matching happening behind the scenes. And then we sort of help connect all the dots between you and the classroom. We help you discover the right classroom, so you don't have to worry about, okay, which classroom needs my skills and expertise? How do I prepare for connecting with this class? So we kind of take all of that out of, you know, your plate and the teacher's plate. So you just have to sign up and say, okay, these are my skills. The teachers sign up and say, this is what I need for my students. And we automatically match and manage the end-to-end process of virtually connecting you with the classroom for a live interactive discussion. And then we do have another question. Would like to get the implementation details of your STEM plan so as to include you in your project. This is Meha. Could you please email me at shabri@nepris.com, shabri@nepris.com. I'll be happy to share our STEM plan. What is the best advice you have ever received in your profession? So I love this question, because I've often thought about this. I've always had the good fortune of having great mentors. In fact, one or two have really helped me shape me from being a fresh college graduate to taking on more important roles within my previous company, and then actually giving me the confidence to go into entrepreneurship. So the best advice I've received so far is from my previous boss at Texas Instruments. He always said that, you know, you may be passionate, you may have a lot to offer, but you really have to listen to people. And I can tell you, I still don't have that down. I still have trouble stopping myself and listening, paying attention before being eager to share my thoughts and opinions. But it does come with practice, and you have to have a lot of discipline to do that. But by far, that is the one advice I think about on a regular basis and consciously try so hard to practice. Still haven't perfected it, but listening is such an important leadership skill. Just by listening to someone, you just make them feel more important. You immediately build a strong relationship with them. You gain more respect by giving the other person the podium. So I think that's been my best advice I've received so far. How to engage girls from government schools with lack of resources to get involved in your Nepris solution? So I'm assuming this question may be from a different country, not the US. I mean, one of the things with technology is it can help bridge geographic barriers, right? But you also have to be in a location where there is at least some accessibility to technology, right? So I would advise you to look for a sponsor company. Many companies want to contribute to helping rural schools, especially girls in rural schools, help connect with professionals. For example, I was meeting with one of the largest oil companies in Texas, and we were having a conversation about them contributing to schools in the US. And they said, you know, we want to actually bring this opportunity to schools in Brazil. And when we talked about the technology barriers, we said, okay, if these are rural schools, how will they connect using technology? You need a good internet connection. You need at least a basic computer. So these companies are really motivated to help sponsor and build that infrastructure for you. So as much as technology can help bring these opportunities to you, you have to have some basic technology. And I would reach out to your local multinational company or a local organization that's committed to education outreach to get this basic infrastructure in place. Once you have this in place, you can sign up at NEPRIS today and start using it. So how does NEPRIS contribute towards STEM goals, right? So when we talk about STEM goals, there are a lot of goals. It depends on who you talk with, right? So one of the biggest STEM goals is to get more kids interested in STEM careers. So just focusing on that, getting exposed to STEM careers is easily said than done. I mean, there are kids in rural school districts that are surrounded just by agriculture. There's no other industry around them. So with what we do with NEPRIS is really bridging all these geographic barriers and giving them an opportunity to get exposure. For example, today, when we started, I had this very stereotypical idea that, well, what's elementary school going to do as far as connecting with industry, right? So we're going to focus on middle school and high school. But before we know it, there were so many elementary classrooms that were signing up saying, I want my kindergarten students to talk to a meteorologist because we're learning about weather. I want my second graders to talk to a geologist because we're learning about earth science. And we're learning about measurements. I want my kids to, my girls especially, to talk to a fashion designer and let her show them how measurements are applied in the real world. We've connected rural communities, especially in lower income school districts, with Corning in New York, with Sony, with many different companies across the country and even around the world. So the number one STEM goal that we're trying to accomplish or help companies, individuals, and schools accomplish is increasing the opportunity for exposure to real-world jobs and careers that is closely tied to curriculum so that they can see how what they learn in the classroom, how is it applied in the real world. And in this process, introducing them to role models, not just bringing in someone during career day, but really connecting what they're learning in the classroom and connecting all the dots and showing them how it's applied in the real world. And then in the process, giving them an opportunity to have a direct conversation with a professional like you. I mean, I would definitely say if you're in college and you're an engineering student, the question is how important are internships for an engineering student? I would say it's very, very important. Like I was telling you how I got interested in engineering, it was through an internship. I got an opportunity to do an internship even as early as high school, and that may not be the case for most of you, but if you're in college, getting an internship is so critical for many, many reasons. One, it gives you the confidence to be in a workplace. I think many of us we hold ourselves back thinking, you know, I'm so new, I'm just fresh out of college. And this was me many years back when I graduated college. I used to be the person that would sit in a meeting and think for 15 minutes before I would actually open my mouth and ask a question because I was so afraid I would say the wrong things. But the only way you can sort of get past these barriers is to throw yourself into the mix, get into the real world and try it before you get into a full-time job. So one, just for your own confidence, for your own sake, to build that, you know, momentum and the confidence to be successful in a full-time job. Two, of course, this everybody knows this, you know, when you, today you're competing with a lot of different people from many parts of the world, not just the US. So how do you build your profile and your, you know, resume? It's through volunteer opportunities. It's through internships. Today, even at NEPRIS sometimes, you know, I work in a co-working space. There are lots of startup companies. One good way to look for internships is look at these startup accelerators and startup companies. Many of them don't have the money to hire a full-time person, but they have meaningful work that if you are up to it and you have the motivation and you're being proactive, it's for you to grab, right? So you have to go after these opportunities and find these companies that have these jobs for you to take. And I would start with a bunch of startup companies in your community and look to see if you can at least start with volunteering that can turn into internships, which will position you so well for a full-time job when you're ready for it. So what was the biggest obstacle to achieving NEPRIS entrepreneurship in general? So actually, I have to say, before I started NEPRIS, I was down a different path of another education gaming company, which did not work out. So I know many of you hear only success stories in a startup, but many of us, many of the successful entrepreneurs have many failures before they succeed. And for me, the biggest obstacle, I wouldn't say an obstacle, but the biggest barrier that I had to figure out was how am I going to balance, you know, entrepreneurship, or, I mean, entrepreneurship is not an 8-to-5 job, it's a 24/7 job. How am I going to balance that with family commitments? I have 2 boys, 7 and 9. And it's always a struggle how I'm going to give them the time that they need and how I'm going to still be successful in taking NEPRIS to where it needs to go. For me, having a crucial conversation with my spouse was so important in the early stages of the company. We were actually taking a financial hit. I don't know what the future will hold, but I was just going after a passion. But I couldn't have done it without the support of my family. And I think anyone considering jumping into entrepreneurship, especially from a good job, I think you need to sit down and see what your risk tolerance is. Could you handle it financially? Could you handle it emotionally? And do you have your family support, right? But you can do it. What was the biggest obstacle? Okay, I think we have 6 more minutes and I see another question coming in. I think we might have a time for just 1 or 2 questions. So I actually shared a Google Doc with Kiana, and if you can share that with the group, I think it has some of the data that I was talking about today. It might be useful to some of you. So it's as a co-founder of an organization and the amount of time needed to make it successful, can you share with us what an average day consists of for you? So I will preface my answer with one thing, which is I am not great at time management. So my day might look much better if someone else was in my place that had better time management skills. So don't take what I'm going to say as an obstacle to doing what I do, because I believe you all can do it much better. So I am, my morning starts at 6:30. I wake up in the morning, get my kids out of bed, pack their lunch. This morning was a mad rush because Sunday night we forgot to sign all their folders. So there were like 15 different folders to sign as we are trying to shove cereal down their throat and pack lunch and snack. And so it's always a mad rush in the morning. And I try to plan their lunches a little bit early, but never happens most of the time. So once the kids are out, 7:30, they get dropped off. If my husband is not traveling, he drops them off. So I start my work day at 7:30. I just catch up on a few things, maybe read a little bit of the news. That's just 5 to 10 minutes. Then I directly get into checking my messages of, you know, what are the things that I need to do. So I on good days, I try to make a list and say, okay, by the end of the day, if I can do these 5 things, then I would consider my day successful. But in reality, there are many interruptions, right? As a startup co-founder, you don't have just one job. You're fundraising, you're hiring, you're doing marketing, you're thinking about product, there are customer issues. So even though we have different people focusing on different things, you're still, you know, building this company, and there are many things you have to keep your foot in. I fortunately have a great co-founder who's the CTO who does amazing job with the product that I don't have to really worry much about that. I also have a wonderful team. So anyway, so the all day long, things are mostly, I connect with my different teams, whether it's operations, business development, with marketing. Most of the time, because I moved to Austin recently, I'm actually working from home now. Our office is in Dallas. So I do a lot of virtual meetings. And half of my day is gone in strategic partnership meetings. We're looking for new partnerships. We're presenting the product to partners. We're presenting the product to different schools. So half of the day is gone in talking to customers. And many times, at least once a month for a week, I'm traveling to customer sites, and those days look entirely different. So my kids are still not set in their after-school care. So around 2:45, I pick them up, bring them home, and get back into working at 3 o'clock while they're busy doing their homeworks. And around 5 o'clock, I pick them up, drop them off at soccer, at tennis, whatever they need to go to, and then come back and work until 6:30 while my husband picks them up at 7 o'clock. Then from 6:30 to 9 o'clock is family time. So I'm making dinner, making sure kids come back, do their homework, put them to bed. And I start working back around 9:30. Most of the time I work from 9:30 to 12:30 at night. So anyway, I hope that answered your question. I know things will get better as our team grows. We have 6 full-time people today and around 8 contractors already. I've learned to delegate a lot, and we just need to get more and more organized as the team grows. The question is, how soon after graduating from college did you start Nepris, and why is Nepris close to you, and why is it your passion? Now you're forcing me to share my age. I graduated college almost 17, 18 years back, and I only started Nepris 2 years back. So I had 15 full years of working in the corporate world before I actually took the step towards entrepreneurship. So I mean, Nepris is very close to me because, first of all, I'm a mom. You know, I feel like when I went to college, I had a very good education, and I've done well so far. But the one big regret for me was I just followed a path that was set. Eventually I learned to love it and it became my passion, but getting into engineering was not my dream, right? So I felt like my education lacked real world connection. I don't know why I learned calculus, or I don't know why I learned ratios and fractions. I have no idea. And even till today, I have no idea why I learned calculus, right? So really, I've always felt that gap, that school could have been more fun if I knew why I was learning what I was learning. And I want that for my kids. I want them to learn something because they see the possibilities. And that's really what drives me, is creating those opportunities for this next generation to have school as a fun place where they're not just rote learning, but they're having opportunities to connect what they're learning to what could be in a few years. So do's of entrepreneurship for newbies. So one thing I always tell people, I sometimes talk to the executive MBA groups at some of the universities, and I always hear this thing that, you know, hey, I have this idea, I'm going to go put a good business plan together, and I'm going to go raise money and pay myself and live happily ever after, right? But that's not reality, especially these days. If you have an idea, don't start raising money or even trying to raise money until you have a proven product with some customer traction. I know it's easily said than done, but you'll be wasting a lot of time if you're just going pitching your idea to people. Just work with a handful of potential customers and make sure you have a product market fit, that somebody wants to use your product. And eventually you'll find somebody to pay for your product, but to find that product market fit, you have to work closely with a handful of customers, do lean development. Look at Eric Ries's book on lean development. And we are very much a lean development organization. We work very closely with customers. Me and my co-founder Binu, we took the first year almost to build the product, work with schools, work with industry professionals, refine it and refine it over and over again. When we pitched for our first funding round, we actually had over 1,000 teachers in the platform using the product, and we were able to raise the funding we needed. So don't put the horse before the cart. Focus on the product, build it, and then the funding will come. So Kiana, I think time is up. Do you want me to take more questions? So I think we're done for the day, and you all had some amazing questions, and thank you for the opportunity. Thanks to IEEE Women in Engineering for giving me this opportunity to talk to all of you. Feel free to reach out to me if you have more questions. It's sabri@nepris.com, sabri@nepris.com. Please feel free to go check out Nepris, and I encourage you to sign up today to volunteer and share your skills. Thank you so much.